This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. Hugh Hewitt back inside the Beltway to get you to work on this Friday. Lots going on around the world and here at home, especially in the courtroom, and maybe having to do with former President Trump. We'll talk about that and much, much more in the first hour, plus Tarzana and Joe of the Friday edition of the Hugh Hewitt Show. Stay tuned.
Want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
always got a story to tell you, though it's hard to hear him speak.
Morning glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. I'm Hugh Hewitt inside the Beltway on this Friday, last radio day of the week. I'm back in the Beltway for a couple of days. You may remember this song. I'm playing a special intro this morning. It's a song John Andrzejczyk done in honor of his friend, Augie Nieto. And Augie died yesterday. You may remember, if you're a longtime listener of this show, you'll remember that Augie came to the studio, my gosh, it's over a decade ago in California. And Augie developed ALS 19 years ago. And ALS is the worst disease, the hardest to deal with, and it brings out the best and the worst in people. And it brought out the very best in Augie and Lynn and their children, the whole family. Augie founded Life Fitness, I don't know, in 1975, some long time ago, and it was fabulously successful. All the life cycles you use, all the gym equipment. So Augie was Mr. Fitness, and he ran marathons, and he did life cycling, and he made a lot of money, and he did great American, even if he is from Illinois. Moved out to Southern California, and Augie's brand grew and grew and grew. And then he got diagnosed with ALS. And ALS is usually a 3 to 5 year fight. But for some people who figure it out and just cope and get great medical care, they can, as Augie did, live for, I don't know, 20 years fighting the disease. And he didn't just do that, though. Augie went out on the road, and he raised money every year with Augie's Quest. And he left a message. Let's bring the music down so I can let people hear this. He said, if there ever comes a day when we can't be together, keep me in your heart. I'll stay there forever, Winnie the Pooh. If you are reading this, then that day has come. As hard as it is to leave my friends and dear family behind, I know my fight is not over. I've battled ALS for almost 18 years. Physically, ALS has taken my body, but my battle to rid the world of this insidious disease will continue. I know I have a lot to be thankful for. I was luckier than most and was able to enjoy those close to me longer than so many friends with ALS. I'm thankful for my family as I count them as the finest achievement of my life. I'm thankful for my friends who stayed by my side and were a constant reminder of how precious life is in spite of its difficulties. Please keep me in your hearts. Please help continue the progress of Augie's Quest to cure ALS. And please help Lynn carry on the mission, the second finest achievement of my life. Because I will be in your heart, I will get to experience the joy we discover when we discover a cure. Thank you for making my life better by virtue of being in it. Forever in your heart, Augie. Our friend John Campbell, who is on the Tuesday edition of the Highly Concentrated Hugh podcast, has been my friend for a long time. He was Augie's friend forever. They were in YPO together. And I think he first introduced me to me or told me about it. And then John arranged for Augie to visit me in the studio. And then I went to one of Augie's Quest, the fundraisers where John performed, and it was just wonderful. The guy raised $200 million for ALS research, and he did it in an extraordinary way. Grants were made on an ongoing basis, meaning that if the research wasn't producing results, they cut off and move on, just sort of like product delivery. Because basic research into ALS could go on forever, but Augie wants a cure. Augie's Quest is for a cure. So a great American who took adversity and turned it into being able to help other people. Augie Nieto left us yesterday. So pray for him, pray for his family, and continue to support Augie's Quest. And everyone out there with ALS in your life, in your own life, or in your family's life, or your friend's life, understand it's a winnable disease. That progress is happening every day, and it's going to come. Let me begin with the news of the day, with the most important headline. I'm not sure many people will cover this headline. Well, let me begin by telling you, I'm back in the Beltway. I'm coming back to California tomorrow. It's a very tricky thing to time when the weather is terrible in California and get to D.C. on the day when it was 80 degrees, sunny. Friday, yesterday, we had meetings all day. When the cherry blossoms are out in Northern Virginia, where I live, it's extraordinary. I don't think I've ever seen it since 1983 when I first moved here. And I visited in the 70s, but I just never have seen the cherry blossoms come out in February. Now, that's not great for the tourism business, but it's spectacular for people who live here. People are out taking pictures. Now, it's not, I don't know if it's everywhere, but they have this early thaw. It was 80 degrees yesterday, 80 degrees in February in Virginia. It'll be back into the 30s tomorrow, so I'm going back to California after the winter storm is over. But the most important thing, Americans obsessed with winter, is this story. U.S. to expand troop presence in Taiwan for training against the China threat. The U.S. is markedly increasing the number of troops deployed to Taiwan, more than quadrupling the current number to bolster a training program for the island's military amid a rising threat from China. The U.S. plans to deploy between 100 and 200 troops to the island in the coming months, up from 30 there a year ago, according to U.S. officials. The larger force will expand the training program the Pentagon has taken pains not to publicize, as the U.S. works to provide Taipei with the capabilities it needs to defend itself without provoking Beijing. Stop worrying about provoking Beijing. It's not like they don't know. It's not like their, quote, wolf warrior diplomats aren't poking their eye in America every day. They are. And now they're thinking about lethal aid for Ukraine. And that will escalate the war there. But do not worry about what your enemy is going to do. That's appeasement. Trying to beg them not to do things and worrying about what they will, their feelings. It's what led to this catastrophe in Ukraine a year ago is the perceived weakness of President Biden after he skedaddled from Afghanistan with 13 dead American troops in his wake and thousands, tens of thousands of abandoned green card holders, American citizens, SIB eligible people. Weakness breeds conflict. Strength doesn't. So this is a good move. Don't worry about publicizing it. A federal judge has ordered depositions of former President Trump, FBI Director Wray, in a long-running dispute with ex-FBI officials. It's not ex-FBI, it's Peter Strzok and Lisa Page. They disparage the president in private messages about him. They claim they have proved that FBI bias fueled the Russia probe. Trump has said that forever. He said it to me. The former president said it to me recently. And, of course, he's angry with Strzok and Page. And I don't know what they intend to do, but they get deposed, too, in the course of this thing. So while you might be focused on the potential deposition, 2 hours limited to a precise set of questions, don't be. Understand that Strzok and Page are going to come under endless discovery. And they're counting on you to not pay attention to it. They're trying to change the narrative because their reputations are shattered. They lost their job. And the question is whether or not they're going to be able to persuade anyone that Donald Trump did something wrong. And that is not going to be the case. Other headlines. In the fog of East Palestine's crisis, politicians write their own stories, according to the New York Times. CNN did a town hall. I missed it on Thursday night from East Palestine. And it's 40 miles south of Warren, where I grew up. It's a fine little town, about 5,000 people, high school. The East Palestine Bulldogs have about 300 people in it. It's just an amazing place to go and to grow up. But I will tell you this. I used to go down there when the basketball team would go. We would normally play East Palestine in tournaments at the end of the year. So that's what I know about. Not much, because they were 40 miles away, a little bit down the road. But it was a beautiful town. And Joe Biden and Pete Buttigieg ignoring it until yesterday is pretty extraordinary. Now, Pete Buttigieg did speak to it yesterday, cut number 10. I'm not sure where he was when he was talking about this. I don't know if he went to East Palestine, but our TriCaster is not cooperating with us.
In retrospect, should you have come a little sooner?
So, again, in terms of the timing of the visit, I'm trying to strike the right balance, allowing NTSB to play its role, but making sure we're here in that show of support.
Okay, cut number 11.
Both information and misinformation injected into this situation, none of which is to the benefit of the community when it comes to that misinformation.
The Norfolk's are
so... You can't talk your way out of this, Pete. Everyone knows. The gig is up. Everybody knows. I don't know what you've been doing. Whatever it is you're doing, it isn't working. And so he blames, of course, Biden playbook 101. He blamed President Trump. Cut number 12.
Yeah. You mentioned a national political figure who's decided to get involved. It sounds like you're talking about Trump. And then you said, I need your help. How can he help?
Well, one thing he could do is express support for reversing the deregulation that happened on his watch. I heard him say he had nothing to do with it, even though it was in his administration. So if he had nothing to do with it, and they did it in his administration against his will, maybe
all right,
he
stop
could come
right
out
there.
And say,
that's just sophistry. That's just absolute sophistry. I'm playing it for you to know that there is nothing Pete won't say. Really. He's a Rhodes Scholar or all that good stuff. Great. I thought he was pretty impressive. That's an outright lie. And the secretary knows that. Stay tuned, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. I'll be right back. It's Friday. I'm Hugh Hewitt inside the Beltway.
China is exploiting weaknesses in our U.S. patent system, stealing our inventions and technology, and we are helping them do it. Watch Innovation Race Now on demand or buy the DVD at salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. I think this is, you know, I play this every day. It's a way to get out of bed. And for the believers out there, it reminds them, like Catholics say their morning offering, they stop and pray or do their morning devotional. There's a story in the New York Times this morning. Woodstock for Christians. Revival draws thousands to Kentucky town. Not Woodstock. Woodstock was a secular event. It's a revival. It's a classic revival in the Protestant tradition, and indeed in the Wesleyan tradition, the Methodist tradition. Let me read you a bit. For weeks, tens of thousands of people have made a pilgrimage to a tiny Christian college, about 30 minutes south of Lexington, Kentucky, for what some scholars and worshipers describe as the nation's first major spiritual revival of the 21st century. It's very interesting that the new Jesus movie is out this weekend. It's just a fascinating, the Jesus people movement of the 70s converted Greg Laurie in the church of Chuck Smith, and those two became giants in the revival movement on the West Coast in the 70s and 80s, and Greg Laurie's never stopped his evangelical work with the Harvest Crusades. First movie or first documentary I ever made was about Greg Laurie for KCET back in 1992. It got such big ratings that we went on and made Searching for God in America for the entire PBS network because people were fascinated by Greg. Greg's a fabulous preacher. He still is. And this movie is a fabulous movie, but this revival has been pretty unexpected. The unplanned event, that's an understatement, has strained the campus and kept the little chapel filled at all hours. It's not that little, actually. It's pretty big. Prompting administrators to wind down the spectacle and the disruption. Not really. They're just adding some order. Beginning Friday, the school said there will be no more public events. Students said they were ready to return to their normal campus rhythms. Nascent revivals are now breaking out at other college campuses, including at Lee University in Tennessee, Cedarville University in Ohio, though it remains to be seen if they will sustain the same fervor seen in Asbury. The revival at Asbury began on February 8th, when a few dozen students lingered after an extraordinary morning chapel service to continue singing, praying together. Word about the spontaneous gathering spread on campus, and by evening, students were dragging mattresses into the chapel to spend the night. Within days, their enthusiasm had exploded into a national event. The university estimates that the revival has drawn more than 50,000 people to Wilmore, Kentucky, a sleepy town of 6,000, like East Palestine, where the grocery store hosts the weekly Bible study and police cards read "In God We Trust." Yeah, that's the interesting. This is the New York Times, a completely secular place, acting like they fell through the rabbit hole and they're in Alice in Wonderland. Asbury was founded in 1890, and its roots are in the Methodist and Wesleyan holiness tradition, which has a historical emphasis on the transformative movements of the Holy Spirit. Asbury, with its campus set in rural Kentucky, has a mostly white student body. Okay, why is that there? It is not an HBCU, but it's like mostly white in the way that most colleges in America are mostly white. It reflects the demographics of the country. It doesn't even have the details. But the revival itself attracted a slightly more diverse crowd. What a sneering line. A slightly more diverse crowd. Now I would love to know from Asbury, what is the makeup of their student population? And you got to know that Ruth Graham, and who wrote this, is just sneering. There's a lot of that in this article built in. And in the photographs, and in the people they quote. They go find the LGBTQ kid who's been across the street at the seminary, who's estranged from his other people. And it's just, by any definition, a revival is character. She found a quote, right? "It's like Woodstock," said Nick Hall, 40, an evangelist from Minnesota. What would Nick Hall know about Woodstock? Really, what would he know? Zero, zip, nada. And it goes on like that, detailing the Asbury revival. Now, I don't know what's real, what isn't, in a New York Times story about a revival, but I know it's a pretty significant deal for the people who go. And Gen Z is not normally associated with revivals, and millennials aren't associated with revivals, but Christians in the Protestant tradition have been praying for revival like the 1970s movement again and again. I think the first person I heard talk about that was Dr. James Dobson when I visited him at Focus on the Family in the early 90s. He said, "I'm just praying for a revival here because we need one." And so they got one in Asbury, and whether or not it catches, it's not a great awakening. It's not that. The great awakening occurred all over the United States. don't compare it with that, but it's a significant event in religious history, and my hat is off to Asbury for hosting it, and I hope it spreads. I hope you also spread the use of this. Look, I've got it in my Beltway studio. It's relieffactor.com time. I carry in curcumin, resveratrol, and omega, and I narrowly avoided the rotator cuff disaster. Getting off the plane in D.C. at D.C. Reagan on Wednesday night, and there was a fellow who was at the front, a row further ahead of me, and he was trying to move backwards to get to his luggage, which he'd put in an overhead bin over me. I said, let me get that down for you, but I'd already gone past it. I reached back with my left arm. I started to pull it. If you're watching on the Salem News Channel, you'll see this Jack LaLanne fluidity. I put my hand up, and I started to pull it, and think he was carrying bricks. And I said, you know what? I'm going to let you get that down, because I knew exactly what would happen. And that is the deal with overhead bins. You've got to be in front of it with both arms. Do not try and take them down. I just know it. But relieffactor.com at least let me get limber enough to make the try. And the guy laughed. Said, no, I'll get it down. I know. It's, and he's acknowledging. He's like a book salesman or something. I'll be right back, America. Go to relieffactor.com, 1995. Get you started. I'm Hugh Hewitt. It's Friday. Stay tuned. Good morning, America. That music means Sonny Bunch, the official movie critic of the Hugh Hewitt Show, is in the house. Good morning, Sonny.
Hi, Hugh. How are you?
I'm great. You wouldn't believe it, but the cherry blossoms are actually out already in Washington, D.C.
Oh, man.
I know, it was 80 degrees here yesterday. I'm leaving again because this is all a false flag operation by the climatologist. I got to ask you very quickly, are you going to see The Jesus Revolution, the Greg Laurie movie?
Probably not. I don't even know what that is. I've not
Kelsey Grammer stars as Chuck Smith, who led the Jesus People Revolution in the 70s in Southern California, and it's got a good budget and a good cast. It's not a Fandango or whatever they call those things, those one-day events. It's a release. It's in general release. I was just wondering if you'd...
A Fathom
event. It's not a Fathom event. It's a real movie, but I haven't seen much about it, but I have seen it. What is new? Is there anything out there in the desert that is American cinema in January and February?
Well, you know, it's interesting that you mentioned that movie. Now that you mention it, I can say that I have heard of it, but it is definitely part of the, you know, kind of counter industry, the shadow industry that exists entirely in another realm, right? I mean, there's a whole universe of these movies, you know, the God's Not Dead type things that don't get promoted in the regular ways and still do decent business because they have, you know, they do their advertising through churches and through that sort of stuff.
And the Jesus Revolution has got a big name, Kelsey Grammer. And then it's got the guy who has played Jesus in The Chosen, which has audiences in the tens of millions. And so he does a bit of the... But I've seen their stream of ads, because, of course, we're on Salem Broadcasting, Salem Media, which is faith-based in its origins and in much of its broadcasting, the Christian side of the radio group. This is a secular side. So it's come across my desk, and I know Greg, and I had Chuck Smith on the show when he was alive. So it's an interesting development that there is a parallel universe. I'm not going to call it the shadow. A parallel universe that is not seen by a lot of Americans.
Yeah, no, it's just it's interesting. It's interesting that you mentioned that. I'll try and check that out again. I am not aware of it because it does not have the kind of standard advertising rollout. But I'll try and see it. Cocaine Bear. You know, Hugh.
Cocaine Bear? Well, that's quite a switch from the Jesus Revolution to the Cocaine Bear. Okay, tell me about Cocaine Bear. I haven't heard of that. I missed it completely.
This is why, you know, Hollywood is full of degenerates. No idea about the Jesus movie, but Cocaine Bear, everyone in America knows about Cocaine Bear. Cocaine Bear. So Cocaine Bear is an interesting movie because it promises you one thing. Can you guess what that thing is, Hugh?
Dissolution.
Well, it promises you a bear on cocaine. I mean,
yeah, that's what I mean. But I'm going
minded now.
I'm going to the end point of every cocaine addict I've ever heard of. It ends up in dissolution. But go ahead.
This movie is one of these kind of high concepts, almost meme movies. Remember Snakes on a Plane?
Oh yes,
Snakes on a Plane.
Oh, I never saw it, but. But I saw all the trailers, and everybody saw Snakes on a Plane, and they know what they mean.
Yeah, right. So Snakes on a Plane is kind of the model here. You have a movie that is essentially a meme, or a meme waiting to be born in terms of what it is for the broader culture. Snakes on a Plane is kind of an interesting movie, not because it's good, because it wasn't good, but because it's the first movie that was really given rewrites by the internet. It at one point in its life, it had been a pretty straightforward thriller. It had been there were snakes on a plane, but it was a thriller in the air, you know, something like a Turbulence or an executive action, some executive decision, something like that. And when the internet found out about it, you know, there was all this talk about, you know, it's got Samuel L. Jackson, and, you know, it's the sort of movie where you expect to hear him say, I'm tired of these MFing snakes on my MFing plane. And that was, the movie was literally rewritten to give him that line, to put the line that the internet wanted him to say in the movie.
Oh.
Cocaine Bear, is very much like this, in the sense that this is a movie where you have a bunch of people standing around shouting lines like, "The bear did cocaine," and the bear is doing something like weird and silly, and you're supposed to turn that image into a GIF and put that on Twitter. That's what this movie is.
Oh my gosh.
It's a meme.
It's trying to look for a viral moment and trying to get people in to see it and laugh, and probably those people are stoned or whatever it is. Do you remember Mr. Wolf from Pulp Fiction?
Sure, yeah.
I was talking about him last night with my son, because you were talking about how there are the wolves in American media that they're sending to clean up messes in the American media. And that guy, they didn't intend him to be the great character that he became, a kind of an icon of deliberate ruthlessness in fixing disasters. Is there a theme that came out of Snakes in the Plane, or a theme that comes out of Cocaine Bear that is like, that will lead to a wolf-like character in the American imagination?
Well, no, because everybody in this movie is incompetent. I mean, this movie is it is very much structured for the bear who is on cocaine to be the hero of the thing. Think about Jaws, right? And Jaws was the title character, but Jaws was, you know, everybody wanted to stop Jaws. Stopping Jaws was the point of that movie. And I do not think stopping the cocaine bear is really the point of this movie. The cocaine bear really is, in a very real way, the hero. Everybody else is kind of a goofball or an idiot.
And what's the takeaway line from Jaws?
We're going to need a bigger boat.
Bigger boat. That's it. And so if you've got a takeaway line or a takeaway character, you've succeeded in penetrating the collective imagination of America. Does Cocaine Bear have such a moment?
I really don't think it does, honestly. I mean, one of my editors asked me this, like, is there like a line from it that, you know, is great and will be, you know, passed around? And I don't think there is. I really don't think there is. It's a weird movie because it is only doing one thing and it does that thing. It is also kind of shockingly brutally violent.
Pulp Fiction was too, wasn't it?
Yes. But I mean, this is a hard R horror movie in a very weird way. There's lots of gore, and most of the laughs in this picture. It's a weird movie because most of the laughs come from shocking moments of unexpected violence, I would say. If that is the thing that made me laugh more frequently than anything else that happened.
Once upon a time in America had a lot of violence in it, but I still went to see it because it wasn't gruesome, right? It wasn't.
Yeah, this has some pretty gruesome violence.
I'm not going to go see it. I don't like gruesome.
Limbs separated from body. So I want to give people fair warning.
Yeah, that's a good warning. Yeah.
This is not a goofy funny sort of movie, but it is goofy and it is kind of funny. It is also just very very brutally violent.
So you're talking about Anchorman yesterday at a meeting with some Salem executives, and we're talking about Will Ferrell and Anchorman. That had body parts dismembered too, but it wasn't gruesome. It was hilarious, right? So there are different ways to do violence, and if you're laughing, it's not gruesome. If you're shuddering, it is gruesome.
Yeah. Well, I mean, look, the violence in this is both gruesome, and I did laugh. Now that may be just because I'm a bad person. I don't know. That's entirely possible.
I don't think you're bad.
But I did find it kind of funny, mostly because it was surprising. Again, this has not really been sold as a hard R horror violence type movie. And it really kind of is that in a way. You know, I mean, it harkens back to some of the 1970s and 1980s creature features, right? Like movies like Alligator. That sort of stuff.
Oh yes.
Where you definitely look. It again. It's a simple movie, and it is.
I liked Alligator.
Not winning any Oscars.
Nobody remembers Alligator, but Alligator is an underappreciated genre of American moviedom.
Well,
the big beast.
Alligator is it's huge. It's having a big moment now. It's one of Quentin Tarantino's favorite movies. He has championed it. It's out on 4K and stuff. People are rediscovering Alligator, I think.
Is Tarantino going to do another movie? Because it seems like I have to wait for Tarantino movies to go.
He says he wants to make one more. He says he wants to make one more. That would be his 10th, and then he wants to retire after that. So,
That's a little bit. No, award season, Sonny. I got to get your commentary on the Oscar nomination. There's just nothing to see. We think Tar, we didn't finish Tar. It was so slow. We didn't finish it.
Yeah. You know, you and my wife both.
Okay.
This is one of those movies that I think really benefits from being seen in a theater. Not because of the big screen and not because of the sound, though both of those things are good and helpful and I am pro them. But because when you're in the theater, you are focused entirely on what's happening on the screen. You're trapped. You're in the theater. You're there for the long haul. So, you know, the way Tar is kind of structured, it's a series of very slowly accumulating details until, I don't know what point in the movie you
think
bailed.
We made about an hour in and we faded.
Okay.
So
it's a series of very slowly accumulating details until her life falls apart with rapidity, like just very, very fastly. And that is how, you know, it's kind of how life is, really, right?
Yes.
But I totally also understand why, you know, normal viewers watching it at home kind of are like, why am I watching this? Why am I doing this to myself? And bail on it.
Let's turn it over to Sherlock or something. Yeah, let's watch it forever. Yeah. It's hard for movies if they don't grab you in a home situation for the reason you just said. There's no sunk cost, right? You're not glued to your seat by a $20 investment.
Yeah, exactly. No, The reason I am most in favor of theaters is because it commands your attention in a very real way that watching at home does not. It's an entirely different viewing experience. When people talk about the movie theaters, they're like, oh, you know, I want the big screen experience. I want the IMAX screen, and I want the big speakers, and I want to be surrounded by sound. And like, all of that is important to a certain extent, but I do think that the actual real benefit of theater is just having your attention monopolized.
Focused. Sonny Bunch, you can go and watch his podcast or listen to Across the Movie Aisle or The Bulwark Goes to the Movies. Sonny has two a week. He'll be back next week. Thank you, Sonny Bunch. I'll be right back, America. Stay tuned to the Friday edition of the Hugh Hewitt Show from the Beltway is underway. Hi, it's Hugh Hewitt. Eric McTaxis's new book, Letter to the American Church, is a must-read wake-up call for American Christians on what needs to be done now and, in fact, needed to be done yesterday. Get Letter to the American Church. Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt inside the Beltway, joined by Tarzana Joe on a wet and cold West Coast. Hello, Joe.
Hello, you. It's raining out here like the day Noah's neighbors took notice. It's coming down.
I'm glad I'm on the East Coast then.
This poem is a little different. You're really going to like it or you're not. I try to strike a balance, okay?
All right.
Regard the ant and termite, the coral and the bee. All of these are prosperous, but none of them are free. They feel the storm, they see the rain, they tremble at the thunder. They see the flash of lightning, but never do they wonder. And yet, they're so well organized, their royalty, prolific. Our government's incompetent and not at all terrific. They build a quick cathedral, while ours take generations. They build by only instinct, ours by regulations. Today there are some intellects studying our messes who come to the conclusion we should learn from their successes. Work with dedication, find your place among the masses, do what you were born to do, and don't take AP classes. This social engineering will surely work out fine as long as no one in the group decides to leave the line. Imagine a world, I'm glad I can't, if there were one ambitious ant. That's Equity by Tarzana Joe.
Joe, I love Equity. Oh, I think good. That's fabulous, because we are worried about the war on merit. You and I went to high school in an era where the smart kids took the hard classes, and the pretty smart kid took the hard classes, and the not-so-smart kid took really above-average classes, but everybody got a shot, right? Now you can't take really hard classes if you're in the wrong school.
What is the point of education without challenge?
Well, that should be a line in the poem. Maybe next week's edition. Tarzana Joe is available at tarzanajoe.com. Will Equity be posted at tarzanajoe.com?
As soon as we complete our conversation.
And then, if people need poetry for any occasion, including to celebrate the retirement of a teacher who perhaps used to teach AP classes, go to tarzanajoe@reagan.com, tarzanajoe@reagan.com. And Joe, your rates are reasonable. Are they inflationary?
Not at all. I'm fighting
I don't
inflation.
Believe that.
I don't natural gas.
So. Oh, okay. That's true. Typing isn't going to use carbon. And it's also very green. You're a very green guy, Joe.
Except that I print out everything three times and I have to recycle the paper.
No, you just lost half of the millennials who were going to commission you. TarzanaJoe@reagan.com. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you, you.
I got to do the market report because Birch Gold sponsors that every morning. Go to HughGold.com, HughGold.com, and let me find what happened yesterday. It was not a terrible day on the market, but I have misplaced my statistics. It was not a terrible day in the run-up to the anniversary of the war, second war of Ukraine, and so that meant the markets might have been cheered. The Dow was up 108, the NASDAQ was up 83, and the S&P was up 21 yesterday. Gold this morning is at $1,824, down a little bit from when I last reported that to you on Wednesday. And if you're buying gold, do it from HughGold.com, HughGold.com. If you're going to open up an IRA or 401k or a SEP IRA for 2022, which I believe you can do until April, head over to HughGold.com. They are third-party intermediaries with thousands of five-star ratings at Yelp and other rating services because people love Birch Gold, either just to buy gold, and that's where I bought my gold before, they just deliver it to your house, and then you put it in your safety deposit box. Don't leave gold at home. It's stupid. A, you'll forget where it is, and B, people will take it. So put it in your safety deposit box. But if you need to open an IRA or a 401k, you need a third-party administrator, and that is Birch Gold. Text Hugh, H-U-G-H, to 989898, or go to HughGold.com, HughGold.com. I also want to remind everyone of MyPhDWeightLoss.com. Generalissimo is off today. MyPhDWeightLoss.com is what Generalissimo used to go from 240 pounds to 190. And it's really remarkable. And we've had a lot of testimonials from you folks out there who have wanted to lose weight for a long time. and you listen to Dwayne drop steadily over the 12 weeks, took 12 weeks to lose it, and he's kept it off for months. He's going to keep it off because it's a pretty easy to work program, and it's not stupid. It's not diet cookies and milkshakes. You don't go on a journey to any particular place and experience. It's just sensible, practical, accessible, counseled weight loss. And I'm going to go find the owner operator of one of these things pretty soon and talk to people about medically supervised weight loss, because that's the way to lose weight. Some people think Weight Watchers is great, but I think myphdweightloss.com is remarkable, and Dwayne's done an amazing thing. And Kurt came in yesterday and said, where'd you go to? Kurt Schlichter was guest hosting for me yesterday, and I thank him for doing so. He looked at Dwayne and said, what happened to you? I said, with 4/5 of Dwayne. And it's not 5/5 of Dwayne anymore. He's down to 190. He'll be back on Monday, and I'll be back in the West Coast tomorrow. But come back for hours 2 and 3 of today's Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by PhD Weight Loss and Nutrition. Go to myphdweightloss.com to learn more.
This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, back inside the Beltway for a day. It was 80 degrees here yesterday. The cherry blossoms are out in February. Anyway, I talked with Admiral Stavridis about what's going on in Russia on the anniversary of the second invasion by Russia of Ukraine. And Sarah Westwood brings us our Friday roundup of what's going on inside of the halls of Congress. All that and more coming up on this hour of the Hugh Hewitt Show.
You won't want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
Morning Glory America, bonjour, hot candidates, Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway. In-laws and howitzers, HIMARS and tanks. Those have been almost headlines on a weekly basis of new weapon systems sent to Ukraine. It's been 52 weeks to the day that Putin launched his second invasion of Ukraine. This one intended to topple Zelensky, absorb Ukraine back into Russia, or actually just absorb it back into what was a reconstructed Soviet Union. Ukraine is an independent country. The war crimes that have been committed in this is one story. The other is, this is a grinding, brutal ground war of the likes we have not seen. I was reflecting yesterday that following this war is a lot like our parents and grandparents must have felt when they followed the war in 1940 and 1941 up until Pearl Harbor, when America wasn't involved, but we were giving destroyers and arms and weaponry and support to Great Britain as it stood alone. William Manchester's famous volume, second volume of his three volumes on Churchill, is simply Alone, and it's about the early war years. And then this third volume is about when Churchill was prime minister, when he re-enters the cabinet. And so Alone, I can't remember if Alone finishes when he re-enters the cabinet at the Admiralty after Munich and after the invasion by Hitler of Czechoslovakia. But Americans watch from afar with interest, and FDR would send weaponry and systems and make commitments to Churchill. He sent Harry Hopkins over in January of 1941, and Hopkins said, "Whither thou goest, I goest. Your God shall be my God." And then Hopkins added, "Until the end," and Churchill wept. And so for a year, we've been providing Ukraine with aid, and they're still standing. And not only are they standing, they're taking back ground. They're a lot better than they are. They're much better off right now in terms of the front lines, but not in terms of the carnage. Ukraine is a much poorer country today. Tens of thousands of Ukrainians have been killed, along with about 100,000 Russians killed or wounded. Could be higher than that. We don't know. No one gives us any details. There is a fantastic story in the Washington Post about the Wagner Group and the convicts, two of them, who, it's against the Geneva Convention to make a spectacle of prisoners of war. So many Russian prisoners of war are in the hands of the Ukraine, and they're being treated in accordance with the Geneva Convention. But the Post wanted to talk to them to find out what their stories were. So they blurred the images and they removed the details, but they authenticated the stories by reference to publicly available Russian databases. And these men were indeed in prison. They were offered a pardon if they went off to fight, and they were both wounded, and 50% of their unit was killed. Because they don't know what they're doing. They're not soldiers. They're conscripts with no training, drawn from prison. So they're hard men, most of them. And they are desperate men, and so they will advance. And I'm reminded of nothing so much as Iran's march against Iraq and the deadlock that developed there. And that deadlock went on for a decade, the Iraq-Iran war. I think it was Robert Gates, but it might have been Henry Kissinger, who said it's a shame both of them can't lose. That's not the case here. We want Russia to lose. It's in our national interest for Russia to lose. Yesterday, the Pentagon announced $2 billion in drone and anti-drone equipment to Ukraine, good. They are also providing direct pipelines to American manufacturers now, good. All of that is good. I gather on yesterday's show, Dr. Hendricks, Jerry Hendricks, who's our go-to Navy guy, told Kurt, who is an Army guy, and therefore they don't speak the same language and they have to use a translator, and that's usually me. But Kurt and Jerry were talking about the fact that Japan has developed a new destroyer and they're rolling off the lines there. I didn't know until yesterday that we couldn't buy the Mitsubishi destroyer. I didn't know that. I thought we could. So, Jerry, you've left me uneducated. But that seems to me to be a stupid law when you are facing an international competition between two blocks and some on a line. The block of the West, led by the United States, the block of the East, led by China with its vassals, Russia and Iran. And they're vassal states. They don't exist. They fall down if China doesn't prop them up. That's quite a revolution from when I was young and went to work for Ronald Reagan. But it is the fact that the bipolar conflict is back. We don't have a multipolar conflict anymore. We have little wars all over the place. They have nothing to do with America's national interest, and we're not getting involved, but Ukraine does. And I'm glad to see the Pentagon making its announcement. I'm also glad Mark Thiessen in the Washington Post today makes an argument that Ron DeSantis did good and bad. I don't know, I haven't talked to the governor about it yet, when he said no blank check for Ukraine. Mark's argument is that's good in that we need to articulate the strategic objective and only provide funds that advance the strategic objective. If DeSantis is saying that, that's good. If he's saying pull back on peace through strength, which I don't think he is saying, that's bad, according to Thiessen. Ronald Reagan did what had to be done in the 80s, which was supply the Mujahideen through Pakistan. And they had rat lines that ran back into Pakistan, and General Zia did it. And there were consequences for the United States in the advance of Islamist extremism that came back to hurt us terribly in 2001, 9/11. But it didn't have to turn out that way. It turned out that way because the United States took a holiday from history after the Soviet Union fell apart. And you cannot ever take a holiday from history. History will not let you go. And the old Chinese proverb, that which is divided must unify, that which is unified must divide. I got that from Dr. Kissinger's book on China, still the best book, single book on China in the world. That which is unified must divide, and that which is divided must unify. And China has been unifying, and it's pulling together its former vassal states. It wants Taiwan. And the biggest story of the day, which I began the show with, is that we're going from a dozen to two dozen troops in Taiwan to 100 to 200 troops in Taiwan to train the Taiwanese military in ways to defend themselves. And I think that is grand. I think that is important. I think that is the kind of thing America has to do to demonstrate to the Chinese. And by the way, the explanation given that they're being very quiet about it, why? Why are we being very quiet about it? We will defend Taiwan. I think the president has said that a couple of times, and then the White House has walked it back. But we will do that. I don't know why we're quiet about that. We will defend Taiwan. And that means submarines and American carriers and American destroyers. And if we sink Chinese vessels, I'm going to ask Admiral Stav what will happen. The war games are all bad. Admiral Stav is supposed to come up at the bottom of the hour today on the anniversary of the invasion of Ukraine. And I don't want a war with China, but the only way to deter war is for them to understand the way that Putin did not understand, because we did not articulate it for him, that a war against Ukraine, the second Ukraine war, would not be the same as the rerun, that we're not going to run it back to 2014 under President Obama. Joe Biden doesn't want to be Barack Obama. He doesn't want to be that weak. He didn't want to erase red lines. And he started out that weak. He allowed Afghanistan to collapse. It's a searing experience. It will be forever associated with the Biden tenure, whether it's 4 or 8 years. And I don't think it's going to be 8 years. I believe the Republicans will win. They're going to nominate the best candidate based on debates and analysis and interviews. I'm Republican Switzerland. They're all welcome here. Everyone comes on. I'm not trying to trick anyone. We ask the same questions about China and about Russia and about the American economy and about education in America. By the way, yesterday, Sarah Huckabee Sanders, governor of Arkansas, signed a new Education Freedom Act into law. So Arkansas joins Iowa and Arizona in complete school choice. Florida and West Virginia are along the way. Ohio, Governor DeWine is going to get it done with the Ohio speakership. They will, I think it'll shatter the Republican Party if they do not deliver complete backpack funding for Ohio schools. They don't have to worry about rural schools. They just go out and get it done. The other story of the day, which is not really a story of the day, because we don't know what the order is, but it's all over the place. Judge orders depositions of Trump, Ray in long-running dispute with ex-FBI officials. Now, remember, President Trump's been deposed before, and he's always well-prepared, and he always sticks to the script. And this is Strokes, Hail Mary, Stroke and Page, who were fired by the FBI for their inappropriate relationship and text messages and the bad things they did to the United States. Stroke's trying to rewrite history. I think Page is a co-plaintiff here, but I'm not sure. And they've been asking to depose the head of the FBI, Christopher Wray, and the president, arguing that somehow their dismissal violated federal law. Let them go forward. Donald Trump has nothing to worry about and a lot to gain by having that deposition and reminding everyone that from before the time he took office until he left, the permanent administrative state in the national security community especially was opposed to him, did everything they could to block him, and that included Strzok and Page in the most blatant political adventuring I've ever seen from the FBI. Of course, whatever Hoover did, we don't know still, because he didn't keep notes, but we only have an outline of it. But Strzok and Page, we got their text messages. We know what they did. Stay tuned, America. I'll be right back. 1-800-520-1234. If you want to comment on the anniversary of the Ukraine war, 1-800-520-1234. Connection to me, Hugh Hewitt.
The Hugh Hewitt Show is now available on TV. Go to salemnewschannel.com or download the app. You can also watch on Roku and Fire Stick. Salem News Channel, the antidote to the mainstream media.
Wake up, America. It's Friday. You're headed to the weekend, as I am. But my Friday will be spent in D.C., meeting with bosses, etc. And then I'm going back to California because it was 80 degrees yesterday. It'll be 60 degrees today, and tomorrow it's back in the 40s, and all the cherry blossoms that came out early are going to be dead. Paul in Connecticut. Good morning, Paul. Welcome to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Good morning, Hugh. Thanks for taking the call. I listen to your show pretty often, along with some other conservative outlets, and I just kind of get the feeling that national radio hosts are trying to bring the rest of us along to get behind, you know, the what's going on in Ukraine. And I'm no fan of Russia. I just feel like with the amount of money spent over there, it kind of makes it just feels like the country's being neglected.
And now, Paul, let me tell you that you've discerned my intent correctly. I don't speak for other radio hosts. I want you to support fully funding a strategically sound campaign to supply Ukraine with the tools they need. But I don't, like Ron DeSantis, I don't believe in a blank check. I think that it's got to go to winning, and we got to drive Putin back. But, you know, even if you total it all up, it's $500 billion, and we've got a $31 trillion debt to prevent a wider war in Europe. Isn't that worth it?
Well, let's go off that wider war. Putin can barely take Kiev, and then we think he's going to storm into Poland? It's dubious at best, I think.
It's dubious now. It wasn't dubious a year ago when we started supporting them. And if we stop supporting them, Russia will rebuild its capacity quickly. People, that is mighty Mother Russia is still mighty Mother Russia. And they have a lot more resources than all of their frontline states if it goes that way. That's why Finland and Sweden want to join NATO.
I just think that, you know, given their failure on the battlefield, we should have adjust our spending outlook to more domestic issues. Thank you, Hugh.
Okay, thank you, Paul. I will ask Admiral Stavridis about that. What an informed and smart and courteous caller. I appreciate that. Randy in Tennessee. Randy, how are you? Have you seen Schroeder yet?
Hey, I'm doing great. I'm doing great, Hugh. Thank you.
But have you seen Schroeder?
I have not. I've kept my eyes out, and I'll tell him that you're looking for
him. You'll hear him before you see him, and then he will loom over you, and he'll say, so you're Randy in Knoxville. And he'll say, yeah. And then you got to just run, man. Just run.
Hey, any friend of Hughes is a friend of mine. Sure thing, man. Hey, I'm very worried about pushing Russia into the arms of China and starting a what makes the old Axis powers of World War II look like child's play compared to our new stuff. I think that, see, I agree with President Trump, Hugh, that we ought to get these guys to the peace table, stop the killing, stop the war. And I think, you know, your thing, you were just talking about, we'll take our subs and start sinking Chinese naval vessels. Man, this, your grandkids are going to get scared listening to Grandpa talking about starting a war.
Well, they're too young. I was with one of them yesterday. She's 9 months old. She can't hear me. But I will tell you this. If China invades Taiwan, we have to act. That's my position. That's my
Why?
View. Because if Taiwan goes, do you know what happens to the international economy if China gets Taiwan, to Taiwan Semiconductor? You know what happens? We don't make those here. We stop making everything. And
what
therefore,
are the Chinese going to do when we sink their battleship? What are they going to do?
They're going to try, if we say that we will do it, they won't do it. Deterrence, Randy.
Oh, so you're just bluffing. Wow. Hey, why don't we just, start launching the nukes and get this over?
No. Randy, remember, we've done this before. How old are you, Randy?
I'm 58.
Okay, so I'm 67. I was in the Reagan administration. We did this before. Deterrence works. The Soviet Union fell apart. They never went through the Fulda Gap. They never
China
invaded
wasn't East. What they are 40 years ago. China now is a whole different animal. They could lick us in a conventional war.
I don't know about that, and I don't know that we want to get there, but I do believe the only way to prevent that is to be very, very, very explicit that Taiwan is not for the taking. One China, two policies is what we agreed to. One China, two systems is what we agreed to, and if the Chinese break that, we've got to defend Taiwan. Randy, I got to thank you. I got to move on and tell people about relieffactor.com. There it is. It's mine. Luckily, I was still in the studio D.C., so I was able to get to the Beltway studio and take my relief factor this morning and remind you about it as well. $19.95 gets you started. Your weekend could be full of sheltering from the storm. Who'll stop the rain? They ought to be playing that. Make that my next bump, if you don't mind, Adam. The Admiral's coming in. Who'll stop the rain? because it's such a weird day in California that the weekend warriors won't need their relief factor for exercise because they're not going to be out running, except the crazy people. There are the funny thing about California, their races are always in March and April, like the LA Marathon and the half marathons around Orange County. And so I ran them for years, and they're usually in March and April. I don't know about this year. It might be snowing on them. But whatever it is, whether you're in California or in the Beltway or anywhere in between, any of the lower 48 or in Alaska or Hawaii, if you're listening abroad, relieffactor.com will ship you for $19.95 a 3-week starter pack. And you'll find out if you take it morning and evening for 3 weeks and then once a day thereafter, you'll find out very quickly if it works for you. It works for me, and I take it every single morning in the first hour. I take it on the air so you hear me. Open it up, take it. Very easy to do with my lukewarm coffee. And I encourage you to do that today and give it a try. Go to relieffactor.com. It works. It really does work. When we come back, Admiral Stav joins us for the first anniversary of the invasion of Ukraine. And he's long been a proponent of keeping them in the game and in the fight. We'll talk with him about what Mark Thiessen writes today. What is the strategic goal for the United States? And Randy's concern and other concerns by other callers. I hear them all the time. But I believe you've got to understand deterrence theory. It works, but only if you're straightforward and talking directly to the American people about it. And Admiral Stavridis likes to do that, and I like to hear him do it. So stay tuned. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Welcome back, America. Who'll Stop the Rain is my bump music. And that's in honor of the West Coast. And soon, all across the United States, I'm standing by waiting for Admiral Stav to join us on this. It's the first anniversary of the second Putin war against Ukraine, and Admiral James Stavridis, retired United States Navy, joins us, former Allied Supreme Commander in NATO, former head of Southern Command. Good morning, Admiral. How are you?
Doing great, Hugh. How's it going?
It's great. Now, Admiral, what I would like to know from you, if you're going to stand up, if you were back in your old job leading in the Fletcher School, and you were going to address a group of students about the unexpected course and future likely path of the second invasion of Putin on the first anniversary of it, what would you say?
I'd say that Putin has a miscalculated terribly here, and he has led the nation down a whole field from which it's going to break the
Admiral, we're going to stop and call you back. For whatever reason, we can't hear you. So we're screwed up this morning. We've been trying to make this work for a couple of days. Why don't we do it by phone? I don't want people to miss this. I've been waiting to talk to the Admiral about the anniversary, and I don't want to have it distorted. And when it is, because of, you know, they're interesting. Starlink. Elon Musk needs to put a Starlink over the Admiral's house. That's all I can say. That will help us all out in the world if Elon will post a Starlink over there and we're able to connect with him. I would encourage all of you who have a subscription to the Telegraph, which is the Great Britain newspaper that I read. They have in there the five weapon systems that changed the course of the war. And I want to ask the Admiral which one is the most important, but I also want to ask him, what do we have to do next? There he is. So, Admiral, let's go back to the question I posed you. What do we do?
The three things we should be doing at this point are, number one, provide the absolute maximalist amount of military capability.
Admiral, it ain't working. Huh, I don't know what's up. This is like a breakdown of the Starlink connection. Now,
can you hear me now?
We're going to drop your video. Nope, not yet. We're gonna try again, and the echo's got to go away. And I think we are going to have to just call him on the phone. Are you there on the phone, Admiral?
Yes, I'm right here on the phone. It should be pretty clear for you.
That's good. Go ahead.
Okay, so here we are. We're 1 year into this thing, and I think the key question is, what do we do now? Number one, we continue to provide significant military capability, and that, in my view, would include fighter aircraft, notably MiG-29, F-16, both can be done. There are some naysayers that say, oh, it'll take a long time to train to fly the F-16. I don't know. These are trained combat pilots. We're not trying to turn Hugh Hewitt into a fighter ace. We're trying to get
somebody. Thank God for that.
Yeah, exactly. So I think it's the armaments to include ATACMS, the combat aircraft, the longer-range cruise missiles to go after the Black Sea fleet, all of that. Number two, we continue to push on the sanctions. And over time, that is going to have significantly more impact on Russia. And let's face it, the global energy economy is kind of rewiring itself in front of us. But long-term, the economics are deeply against Russia. Point being that if you look at the global economy, on one side, U.S., Europe, Japan, Australia, Canada, South Korea, Singapore, add all that up, that's about 65% of global gross domestic product. On the other side is Russia, which has maybe 2%, less than that now. And even if China completely throws in, which I don't think they will, but if they do, it's still only another 15% on that side of the equation. So over time, big, big storm clouds economically. And third and finally, Hugh, we've got to keep the diplomatic pressure on. And here where I'm worried is China. I'm concerned China may make a mistake here and begin supplying weapons, real military capability to Russia. Again, I think President Xi is too smart to do that, but that is the path of greatest glory. So there's three things we should be thinking about today on this anniversary.
Admiral, I reminded my friend Kurt Schlichter the other day that China did not hesitate to throw hundreds of thousands of troops into Korea when they thought their strategic interests were threatened by MacArthur's advance of the Yalu River. And so if their strategic interests are threatened, they will act in their own best interest. But I don't think they are. Are they by Putin's defeat? Would they actually have their strategic interests threatened?
No, I don't think so. And frankly, I could spin that the other way in two dimensions. One is it's been 70 years since the Korean War. That's a long time ago. Point being, Xi can't have a high degree of confidence one way or the other in the Chinese military, point one. Point two, and more to the question of the strategic interest of China, I can make the case that a badly wounded, limping Russia with a absolutely cracked military coming out of this conflict presents a real opportunity for China. Think about it this way, Hugh. If you're China, you're looking north at Siberia. It's this vast landmass. This is Russia to the east of the Ural Mountains. And nobody lives there. There's, I don't know, 25 million people in an area the size of the continental United States. But what's it full of? Oil, gas, timber, arable land, fresh water, diamonds, gold, rare earths. It looks mighty tasty if you're Chinese, and a weakened Russia presents some interesting strategic opportunities to China.
Now, Admiral, when the Chinese talk about the century of humiliation, it includes Russia taking their northern province, doesn't it?
It does. And, you know, there's not a natural gravitational pull, frankly, between China and Russia. You provide one pretty good instance of it. Let's not forget, during the Cold War, these two communist powers were never significantly aligned, had many disagreements, including philosophies of communism, but all the way to borders and geopolitics, as you correctly point out. And oh, by the way, go back to 55 days at Peking, as it was called then, now Beijing, and it's all part of the humiliation of China, which included Russia.
Now let me talk to you before our audience goes off. Moldova is under an extraordinary... Have you been to Moldova? I'm going to be astonished if you've been to Moldova.
Hugh, of course I've been to Moldova. I've been, I think, twice, maybe three times. Don't forget, it's part of the U.S. European Command's orbit. It's area of responsibility, as it's called. So I've been at least twice. It's one of the poorest countries, perhaps the poorest country in Europe. And the problem, its major problem, is about a third of its territory is already occupied by Russia, which has set up this kind of puppet regime there called Transnistria. And over the last few weeks, we've seen, I think, pretty credible reports that Russia is seeking to undermine the government in Chisinau, which is the capital. So here's the point. Russia is not only making moves on Ukraine, they're making moves on this tiny, impoverished country, Moldova, and they are also quite clearly intent on simply absorbing Belarus, which is a pretty big nation just to the north of Ukraine. The whole thing is part of Putin's, quote, master plan, unquote, to reconstitute as much as he can of the old Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. Moldova, Ukraine, and Belarus, of course, were all part of that.
Now, I know Moldova's elected prime minister does not want that. And I know that Russian propaganda is saying they're threatening the ammunition depot that the Russians control in that Transnistria, whatever it is called. But does Belarus want to be absorbed? They've got their own little dictator going there. Does he want to give everything over to Putin?
Yeah, this is Lukashenko, who often jokes about who's the bigger, badder dictator. It's also kind of amusing to see him and Putin stand next to each other, because Putin's a tiny guy like I am, and his fellow dictator in Belarus just towers over him. He looks like Shaquille O'Neal standing next to Danny DeVito. But the point is, I think generally the Belarusians, the population, has no desire to be absorbed by Russia. The majority of that population pretty clearly wants to lean to the West. They've tried to overthrow their dictator several times. He has cracked down with help from Moscow. This is another one of the color revolutions, but one that didn't really take off. Came very close about 2 years ago, just before pandemic times. The bottom line is that Belarus would like to remain an independent country, but I think Putin has other ideas for them.
I want to close, Admiral, because you were the Supreme Allied Commander of NATO. The only good thing that's come out of a war that's claimed hundreds of thousands of lives and destroyed Ukraine is they brought NATO together. It is going to bring Finland and Sweden into NATO. Poland, I read 2 days ago, is going to put 4% of their GDP into becoming the largest standing army in Western Europe. What do you think about the unintended consequences of this war on NATO, which you used to lead?
Yeah, that distant boom you hear is Vladimir Putin's head exploding with frustration. These are all immensely unintended consequences from the perspective of Moscow, and you've ticked them off very well. Of all of them, I think the most significant, potentially, is Poland, which has a great deal of antipathy for Russia, a long, bad history with the Cossacks and the Russians, and for them to stand up and move forward strongly, vital. Germany is moving along as well, has created a special fund with billions in it. Sweden and Finland, quite correct, they're going to present Putin with a new 800-mile frontier, plus put pressure on his plans for the Arctic. So the silver lining here in this horrific war is, in fact, NATO unity.
Admiral James Stavridis, thank you for joining me this morning. Follow him at StavridisJ on Twitter. He's also often on the media. Always tune in. Put down whatever you're doing. Listen to the Admiral when he comes on to talk about whatever it is he's talking about, because he knows of which he speaks. He's been to Moldova. One of these days, I'm going to find a place on the planet he hadn't been that's going to be in the headlines. I can't go, like, testing him just to see if he's been to a little city in Paraguay. But he probably has been since he had Southern Command. Don't go anywhere, America. I'll be right back on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
China is exploiting weaknesses in our U.S. patent system, stealing our inventions and technology, and we are helping them do it. Watch Innovation Race Now on demand or buy the DVD at salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt. On Friday, Sarah Westwood of the Washington Examiner joins us when we are lucky. Good morning, Sarah. How are you?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
You know, it is amazing. I'm in D.C. for a couple of days. I don't normally come back until April. And the cherry blossoms are out. This is really wild. What do you think?
It's wild. It's supposed to be winter. I was kind of hoping to get snow at least once, but, you know, it's almost sundress season.
Well, it's nevertheless, be careful, because I get out of here because a snow blizzard could come through. Sarah, on the anniversary of the first anniversary of the second invasion by Putin of Ukraine, what is support like for more weaponry in Congress on both sides of the aisle?
I think it's still pretty high, despite the fact that you are sort of sensing some fatigue within the Republican Party. There are, though, some skeptics. You know, J.D. Vance in the Senate is a big one. Some of the conservative Republicans in the House who did not want Kevin McCarthy to be Speaker initially have also sort of expressed some concerns about, you know, the Biden administration not laying out any strategic endpoints for this conflict, and there being so little oversight of the money so far and so little interest from the Biden administration in keeping track of what that money is buying. So, you know, it's a small but growing group, I think, of Republicans who are skeptical of continuing aid at the levels we've been doing.
Now, within the GOP caucus, you have the two Mikes and a Jim, Mike Gallagher, Michael Waltz, and Jim Banks. And they are the public-facing hawks, as is Mike Rogers, of the Republicans. Do they have an open debate inside the caucus? Do they know, you know, they're defending supporting Ukraine and pushing back against the Chinese and building the Navy. Is the debate open, or is it guerrilla tactics between the two camps? Because I think the non-interventionists, maybe even quasi-isolationists, are a small number of Republicans.
It is a small number, but I think you have a lot of different opinions along the spectrum of, you know, let's cut off aid altogether, not one more penny, which...
Oh, what is going on with the internets today? Sarah just dropped. And I mean, it went black. If you're watching on the Salem News Channel, that's the first time we've ever gone to black on her side of the screen. So I'm watching my return, obviously, from my studio. And she just went south. So the Russians must not like what she was about to say. I'm sure, well, maybe we'll reconnect. I don't know. We don't have a lot of time. Sarah is always on top of stuff. And I really wanted to hear that. Jim Banks, by the way, is going to be the next senator from Indiana. And Mike Braun's going to be the next governor of Indiana. And that's over. Indiana's a red state. There is no primary challenge to either of them. The Attorney General of Indiana waved off both. And so Jim Banks cleared the field. Mitch Daniels said he's not going to run, which is good all around. Saves Mitch's from a nasty primary battle that Jim Banks would have won anyway. And so Jim Banks is going to walk right in, sit right down, and become a great senator from the Hoosier State. In the mold of Dick Lugar, he will be strong on national security. She's back. So I was talking about Jim Banks while I filled, Sarah. So how goes the conversation inside of the GOP caucus?
Thanks. Sorry, I talked to myself for a while. So I do think you have Republicans in the middle of that spectrum. You have a lot of them who, the majority of them, want to keep aid going really at current levels. You have a small number like Marjorie Taylor Greene and Matt Gaetz who want to cut off aid altogether, not one more penny to Ukraine. But then you have a lot of Republicans in the middle who question the amounts that we've been sending, the speed at which the money has been dispersed to Ukraine, and whether some of this money shouldn't be attached to strings or at least requirements for more oversight. And I do think that that group in the middle is growing. So maybe there will be some marginal changes to the levels of aid if Republicans had their way. But, you know, I think that the people who want to cut off the aid altogether, their numbers are small.
What matters most is what does Speaker McCarthy think. Now, I hear from Republicans and conservatives and even independents and many Democrats across the spectrum on Ukraine. I had a couple of naysayers earlier this morning and a week of naysayers because they want to be heard and I want them to be heard. But what does Speaker Kevin McCarthy think about aid to Ukraine?
So interestingly, he sort of laid his cards on the table before the speaker race, before even the midterm elections, and said, you know, there will be no more free blank checks for Ukraine. So he sort of sympathized with this group in the middle who do want to see more oversight and potentially more restrictions. You know, we have been putting aid to Ukraine at a sort of historic clip. I mean, this past year, Ukraine has received more aid than Afghanistan did annually at the peak of the war. So this is a sort of an unprecedented speed at which Ukraine has been given money. To potentially slow that down, or to look at, can we prioritize the areas where we're helping Ukraine? Do we need to prop up their agriculture sector, for example, their housing sector? Just re-examining where all that money is going and whether every penny of it is necessary, that's sort of what Kevin McCarthy has laid out. And I do think you're seeing that start to become a more popular opinion within the conference.
That's the Governor DeSantis approach, right? No more blank check. The blank check, the opponents of blank check aid are in the middle between hawks like me and the withdrawal folks, right?
That's right. And, you know, I think Ron DeSantis's answer on this was pretty interesting, because he sort of did a pivot to China, which isn't necessarily isolationist or calling to trim the defense budget. He's just sort of saying that the Biden administration's foreign policy priorities are misplaced. And I think a lot of Republicans would maybe agree with that, that there's some maybe.
I do. I think so, too. Sarah, in fact, I linked Mark Thiessen's column in The Washington Post to the note of your appearance on Twitter, which strikes that note exactly. Good to see you, Sarah. Enjoy the weather in D.C. I'll be right back. The Hillsdale Dialogue is straight ahead, the final radio hour of the week, right here on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. It's Hugh Hewitt coming up the Hillsdale Dialogue. All of the dialogue can be found at hughforhillsdale.com and all things Hillsdale at hillsdale.edu. Dr. Calvert returns this week with a history of ancient Christianity. It's interesting because the revival I covered in the first hour at Asbury College in Kentucky, we'll figure out how that squares up with the ancient Christian world coming up on this hour of the Friday edition of the Hugh Hewitt Show.
You won't want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.